So yesterday we saw that the Lord gave divine vision to Arjun, temporarily made his mind quiet, single-pointed, made him go beyond the body identification, and he had a glimpse. So the cosmic vision, what he saw was reported by Sanjay to Dhritarashtra. Now Arjun starts his description in his own words, that what is he seeing. And we also saw yesterday that how Arjun was full of gratitude, he was full of adulations, and he prostrated to the Lord when he saw that Vishwarup. And that Sanjay also describes that analogy of thousand suns rising at the same time. That is the brilliance of that cosmic vision. So now Arjun starts his description where he says, Pashyami Devan Sava Deva Dehe, 15th verse, that, O Supreme Lord, in your divine body, what do I see? Sarvans Tatha Bhuta Vishesa Sanghan. I see all the different types of beings. And I also see this Brahmanam Isham Kamala Sanastham. Brahmanam is Brahmaji. Isha is our Shivji, and Kamalasanastham, seated on the lotus, or you can even say Brahmanam Isham Kamalasanastham is one description of Brahmaji itself, or one can say Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, whichever one comes. Rishinscha Sarvan Uragansha Devan, all the different types of rishis, all the different types of serpents, and many divine things he sees. Meaning not only human beings. First he doesn't see just the human beings. He sees all the beings. And this one aspect we have to know here is that the concept of God which is there, Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh also, is a concept of Ishvara which is there. With relation to the creation, the Supreme Infinite takes up as though the identity of Ishvara and becomes a creator, sustainer and destroyer. So when the whole thing is seen as the cosmic form, which is infinite cosmic form, God also is seen inside that. Creation, creature, creator. All the three are seen there. So he sees Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, all of them there. So in our culture also we have the absolute is formless. Where there is no world also, non-dual truth it is, and that cannot be described. But there is a concept of Ishvara. Because from that absolute level there is no creation, no creator, no duality, nothing exists. But we are seeing the world. So there has to be a cause. So the cause of that world which we see is called as Ishvara. And that is depicted as creator, sustainer and destroyer. With qualities, each of them have qualities. So Brahmaji has the quality, so he has four heads and he holds the Vedas and he sits on the lotus. So those are qualities which any creator will require. Creator will require knowledge. Creator will require to be rooted in detachment. So those qualities get depicted. And doesn't mean that there is no divine form like that. There is a divine form. Otherwise he can't see that. If it is a human man-made form, how is it possible to see that in the creation and in the cosmic form? So many times we think like that because our intellect thinks only with a limited knowledge that it has. The realm of mysticism is a very different realm. It is not illogical, but it is beyond logic. Everything is not beginning and ending with science. There is definitely place for logic, for science, but there are many things which are beyond the explanation of science. So to say that the form of the Lord is created by some human beings, how will so many Mahatmas otherwise have the darshan if the form doesn't exist? And here he is seeing all that. Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, all that he is seeing. So, one is he sees the divine forms, one is he also sees that Ishwar also is a part of that cosmic, so absolute truth is beyond that concept of creator, sustainer, destroyer. Now he goes ahead and he says, I see many, many heads. I see them in all the directions and I don't see a beginning, I don't see an end. Na antam, na madhyam, na punastavadin. There is no beginning, there is no middle, there is no end. This cosmic form of yours means the concept of space is destroyed. Concept of time is destroyed. And science also tells us, right, the experience of relativity sustains because of time and space. If anybody goes beyond time and space, they will go beyond the realm of duality. To go beyond time and space means what? Go beyond mind. Because time and space both are projections of the mind. In a simple way to understand it, if the mind is engaged in something, some nice movie, some work, something creative, time passes just like that. If the mind is not absorbed in that, one goes on thinking about time, how much time, all that. Chronological time is one thing. But psychological time is the projection of our own mind. And when this mind is asleep, even chronological time doesn't exist. Today, quantum physics has understood that very, very clearly. Einstein said it long back, this whole world is conditioned by time and space. Now, quantum physics has understood that very, very well. And there are so many experiments that they are doing that time is not a linear concept, and why should we be not able to change our past or look at our future? If we identify with the body, then we are not able to change the past and look at the future. But if you go beyond that, then you can see all the three. Hindu culture, such people are called Trikala Gyanis. They can see the past, present and future, all the three. So here in this cosmic form, temporarily Arjuna has been lifted to that state, beyond time, beyond space, his mind has got uplifted. So he says, I don't see a beginning, I don't see a middle, I don't see an end. It's like a fish, maybe, a very limited example, but it's like a fish saying that I don't see the beginning and the middle and the end of the ocean. Everywhere it is ocean only, water only is there. Now he sees the special form of Vishnu Bhagavan. In this 17th one he says, Kiritinam Gadinam Chakrinam Cham. That I see you having this divine crown, one Gada and Chakra, meaning the Shankha Chakra Gada Padma, that form of that Lord as a sustainer. So earlier he mentioned Brahmaji, now he is mentioning Vishnu. So these forms, they also have a certain symbolism, which does not deny the existence of the form, which only gives more meaning to that form. So Gurudev has given a very nice explanation of this, why these four symbols Vishnu Bhagavan has. So he says here, this first Bhagavan blows a conch to wake up the human being, meaning to wake up the spiritual quest. One is asleep, living in the world but unaware, not knowing the higher purpose, not knowing one's own self, somehow existing in this life. He says he blows the conch. So the blowing of the conch means what? Life will bring those circumstances where a person becomes, is forced to think, is introspective. Whichever way, positive, negative, any circumstances it could be, where these deeper questions will arise. So the quest is as though ignited or generated because of the conch. So if somebody says, no, that call of the conch is there inside, but you know, it's okay, leave it, doesn't matter, baad mein kabhi. So then Bhagavan says, I take one gada and give one shot. So life brings such turbulent times, difficult times, which will test that person, and somehow that is called a pang of a new birth. One shot Bhagavan gives, and suddenly one is shaken up. All the tamas which was there intellectually, one is pulled out of that. So one follows the path consistently. As one walks the path, the time comes when the Lord leaves the disc, Sudarshan Chakra. Very nice one. Why the name Sudarshan only? It could have been anything else. The ego is to be cut with that. So that Sudarshan Chakra is such that it will cut the head. Symbolic case, it is a knowledge which makes me see my own self. Darshan means to see. Sudarshan means to see very well. To see it in such a way that you will never forget it anymore. Person whose ego is cut comes to experience that self, that no more that person again falls back to that state of delusion that I am the body, mind and intellect. That is the discuss there. Sudarshan Chakra. Then comes the lotus. When a person has experienced one's own self, one becomes completely detached. One lives very beautifully, like the fully blossomed lotus is a symbol of the complete blossoming of the person, where the person has experienced the infinite, and yet one lives in the world not being affected by the world. So Arjun sees that Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma, this form of the Lord, Vishnu Bhagavan is there. Tejo Rashim Sarvato Ditti Mantam. And he sees that form is very splendorous. Everywhere you will see depiction of Bhagavan is light. That's why we worship light. We are worshippers of light. Bharat means the land where people worship light. Light is the Lord. Light means knowledge. So the Lord is described everywhere. Tejo Rashyam Sarvato Diptimantam. Pashyamitvam Durniriksham Samantam. And it's very, very hard to look at him. Just imagine, how can you look at that form which is so resplendent, which is like thousand suns at one and the same time. One sun to look at, only the eye get blind. This is such a resplendent form, it's very difficult to look at. Deeptanal Arka Dyutima Prameyam. You are burning like Arka and Anala. Arka is sun, Anala is fire. So such blazing Tejas is there, that brilliance is there. It's not just the physical light, it is splendor, which is, you could even call it aura or whatever you want to call it. It's bright and brilliant and very incomprehensible. So now he goes on to say about some of the qualities. So he is not only seeing the physical forms and divine beings, he sees some of the qualities, means what does the Lord do? So 18th verse, very nice verse, let us read that. Tvamaksharam paramam veditavyam. Tvamasya vishvasya param nidhanam. Tvamavyaya shashvata dharma gopta. Sanatanastvam purusho mato me.
Sanatanastvam purusho mato me.
He says, Tvam Aksharam, you are the imperishable. You know, for a seeker to even realize that this is the imperishable truth is a big step. Because all around us, we see everything is perishing only. Where do we have any glimpse of the imperishable? That there is something which is imperishable, and that is only consciousness. Nothing else is imperishable. Body changes, mind changes, intellect changes, ego changes, world outside, people, things, everything changes. So we don't even know the existence of an imperishable. For him to even say that, that means the mind has been lifted to those subtle heights where one can experience or one can have that perception that this is what is imperishable. Otherwise, if he's just seeing the form is perishable. Yes, Tvam Aksharam, you are that imperishable. Paramam Veditavyam, and you are the supreme, and you are the one who is supposed to be known. Meaning the goal of human life is this, that I must know this imperishable truth. If I don't know the imperishable truth, having come to this human life, the whole opportunity is wasted. Because anyway, things are perishable. But here I have a precious chance to know that it is imperishable. And when I know that, I see that this whole thing is an expression of the imperishable only. There is nothing different. So it says this, that you are the supreme to be known. What is that to be known in this world? If there is something worth to be known, it is only this. And we don't have time to know this. We have time to know everything else. Everything which is perishable, I can spend time for it. But to spend 1 hour for the imperishable, to know about that imperishable, abhi samay nahi hai. So he says, no, you are that which is to be known. Paramam Veditavyam. Tvamasya Vishvasya Param Nidhanam. You are the supreme treasure of this whole world. If I really want to accumulate any wealth, I must accumulate the wealth of Naam, Bhagavan's Naam. So the name is the simplest way to connect to the Lord. So he says, you are the supreme treasure. Why? Because having that, one becomes fulfilled. One's security, one becomes very secure. Not knowing the Lord, one remains insecure. Tvamavyayaha, you are changeless. Shashvata Dharma Gopta, this is a very beautiful expression. So Shashvata Dharma Gopta means you are an eternal guardian of Dharma. Dharma Gopta means a guardian of Dharma. Shashvata means eternal. So one way to understand this word, this expression is that you are eternally protecting dharma. This is what should give us the faith. We may think that there is no dharma, dharma is declining, adharma is always increasing. But Bhagavan is the protector of dharma. Even when we feel that dharma is declining, the world is sustained only because of dharma being more than adharma. If adharma at any point in time becomes more than dharma, the world will get destroyed. You think about it. If the world is sustaining even today, it is because of the goodness of so many people. There is a lot of goodness in the world, even today. Perception of ours may be very different. That we may have become trained to see the negatives, and we are bombarded with that all around us. But if we see in our individual lives, is there not goodness? There is a lot of goodness. Even in the society, inherently people are good. Of course, their selfishness and ego makes them feel insecure and one does things out of that, but nobody is that 100% sinner and bad. So he says, one aspect is this, that dharma is protected by the Lord. He is a protector of dharma. And if at all that dharma declines, the promise we have seen in the 4th chapter, he says, I will come. Yada yada dharmasya glane bhavati bhagata abhyutthana dharmasya tadatmanam sujamyam. I will come again and again. So one is this, that he protects dharma. So our faith in dharma should not become less. Because one of the names of Bhagavan Vishnu itself is dharma, in Vishnu Sahasrara. So if he is called as a sustainer, how does he sustain the world? He sustains the world through the right knowledge and through dharma, through dharma. The very desire in anyone to follow dharma, to be dharmic, to be good, is the expression of Lord Vishnu. Otherwise, one thing, sustenance happens by wealth and resources. Anywhere you will see, how do you sustain a family? Real sustenance, functionally one requires physical security, so a house and some money and all that is required, there's no doubt. But the real sustenance happens only when dharma is sustained. If dharma is not sustained, that wealth, the value, the wealth, name, fame, whatever it is, it will destroy the person. It will destroy the family. And you will see that example in so many cases in the scriptures. Ramayana mein you see, he had sone ki lanka. But the moment he fell from dharma and he became adharmic, gone. In some time it got destroyed. Chanakya said, anyayena uparjitam vittam dasha varshani tishtati. The wealth acquired by unrighteous means will stay for 10 years. Prapte tu ekadashe varshe samulam cha vinashyati. In the 11th year, it will get destroyed with all the other good wealth also that you had. With all the principal amount that you invested, all gone. So it's not about only the number of years, it is about the concept. That real sustenance happens only when there is dharma. An organization, you may see them rising very quickly in a short span of time. But credibility, goodwill, long-term sustenance, all that is not possible unless there is dharma in that organization. People won't stay there. And even if they stay, they will keep on creeping. They will not identify. They will be there helplessly. The moment they get a chance, they will go out from there. So what really sustains is dharma. And that faith one must have, that if I am following dharma, the Lord is there with me, because he is the protector of dharma. So anybody who follows dharma is also having the protection of the Lord. Now but why do they go through difficulties? Of course they will go through difficulties. It's not easy to follow dharma. Vasudeva was going to cross the whole Yamuna. He went, he took Bhagavan and he went. And the whole Yamuna was in floods. One can't say that, no, if he is carrying Bhagavan on his head, why did Yamuna go into floods? He should have been given a free passage. And Yamuna should have parted ways and he should have just gone happily. But why did he have to struggle so much? That's the symbolism there. That in the flood of life, to walk strongly, hold Bhagavan in the head and then go. One will not drown. That is the real strength. So Shashvata Dharma Gupta, one meaning is this, that he is an protector, eternal protector of Dharma. Other meaning of this word is, he is a protector of eternal Dharma. Shashvata Dharma Gupta. So our culture is called Sanatana Dharma. And you think about that. How many cultures came and went? You can name them, so many of them. Greek culture, Mayan culture, Roman culture, Egyptian culture, Mesopotamian culture. So many cultures came and went. Not that our culture didn't go through decadence. Our culture also has gone through decadence. How many times? But every time the culture has gone through decadence, some master comes up and then he revives again. Because the inherent qualities of this culture are such that they are in tune with the rhythm of the universe. It is all accommodative. It does not have this, what we call the, it is based on the universal values. It does not have that that concept of non-accommodative, hurting, killing, if you don't follow my culture, none of that. It is based on compassion and love. It is based on service, based on sacrifice. And most importantly, it is rooted in self-knowledge. The crux of the Sanatana Dharma is the knowledge that you are infinite and so is everyone else. If that is the understanding that all of us are expressions of one divine truth, nobody is undivine here, then the whole concept is I, creator, creation, all are one. It is based on that eternal self, the knowledge of that self. And whenever the culture declines, what is the meaning of culture declining? Culture declining means value systems go down, person becomes more body oriented and forgets the true essence in the person. That is called culture decline. So if we say materialism is rising so much, means I am not following the higher values of life for the sake of body enjoyments, I am compromising. So my culture is gone down. Whenever that culture goes down, some Mahatma comes up, Vedavyasa or Gautam Buddha or Vivekananda or Adi Shankaracharya or Mirabai, someone comes up, revives that whole culture, brings the essence of knowledge to people, makes them live the higher value of love and compassion and forgiveness and all that. Again the culture goes in. So who is the one who inspires such people? Bhagavan is the one. Shashvata Dharma Gupta. He is the protector of the eternal religion. So if we go by this eternal religion, it is not limited to Hinduism. We have started calling it as Hinduism. The principles of life which are eternal, that as long as creation is there, these principles will remain. That all of us are divine, whether we know it or not, whether we accept it or not. That the life is to be lived with those higher values of love and honesty and forgiveness and straightforwardness and all that. And that will remain. It's only my choice whether I want to tune up to that and live according to that or I don't want to tune up to that. Like we saw in the third chapter, Yajna Bhavana is the cosmic rhythm. Everything in the world lives in the attitude of mutually serving and giving. The trees, the plants, the rivers, the moon, the sun, everything serves and gives. The human being alone who has the freedom to grab and then one suffers. So as long as the creation is there, these eternal principles will remain. And that religion which is going to be in tune with his eternal principles will remain eternally. But there is a misunderstanding also which comes because of this. Somebody says, anyway, Bhagwan is going to protect our culture. Let anybody come and do anything, we will not do anything. Why? Because Bhagwan is protecting our culture. That is a stupidity. That's why in this country of ours, we Hindus have lost our strength only. And we allow anybody and everybody to trample upon us. Why? Bhagwan will take care. What Bhagwan will take care? He will take care through you and me only. You know, let them come, let them do anything. Why? We are tolerant people. That has destroyed us. One is the concept of tolerance. Hinduism is not a tolerant religion. It's an accommodative religion. When I don't like somebody, I tolerate them, no? When I don't have enmity against anybody, whoever comes, you are my family only. What do I say? I am tolerating you. I say, I love you to be here. That's all. It's an accommodative religion. But no, no, we are very tolerant. Anybody comes and kills us, we don't do anything. That has destroyed us. Wrong understanding of ahimsa and this idea that we are a very tolerant religion. That has only destroyed us. So he says here, Shashvata Dharma Gupta. He is, the Lord is the real protector, there is no doubt. But the instruments are all of us. So if the demand is there in the totality, it remains. That culture thrives, it lives. And that demand is created by these great people who come again and again. Vivekananda rolled from that world parliament of religions and some Hindus woke up in this country. And after he went, again they went off to sleep. Again Gurudev came, he woke up some people. Ramana Maharshi came, he woke up some people. Nisargadatta Maharaj woke up some people. Again after that someone goes. One should think, how long will this happen? Unless the collective consciousness doesn't live up to these values, for that culture to survive is very difficult. And the reason why this is surviving is because it is based on the deepest foundation of self-knowledge. It is not only some values of life. Values of life is the surface level. The reason why this culture is called Shashvata is because it reveals the knowledge which is Shashvata. About the Shastra, the infinite truth is revealed by the Guru Parampara, which is also infinite. And it makes me realize that my nature is also infinite. That self-knowledge is the foundation of the Sanatana Dharma. That's why it is sustaining. And hence Bhagavan sustains through knowledge and through values. When these two are there anywhere, if knowledge and values are there, that community, that family, that organization will survive and do very well. But if materialism takes over knowledge and values, there will be a temporary decline. And at that point in time when decline has happened, if there is nobody to revive it, that will die. Luckily so far, there have been some or the other Mahatmas who have come and revived this culture. So it says, Shashvata Dharma Gupta, that he is the protector of this eternal religion, eternal dharma. Sanatanastvam purushomato me. I consider you are sanatan, you are infinite, and you are the supreme purusha. So purusha means one who enlivens the prakriti. Prakriti is matter. Purusha is consciousness. He says you are that supreme consciousness which enlivens everything. So he goes ahead to say a few more descriptions about this Vishwarupa. We go to verse number 21. So now what all he sees there? Amihi Tvam Sura Sangha Vishanti. Lots of these devatas he sees. Kechi Bhitaha Pranjalayo Granati. And some of them are very scared also. Even devatas get scared. Those, why? Because they are limited beings only. In the Vedic times, you know, people had the goal that I want to become a devata. I want to go to heaven. I want to enjoy those pleasures there. This shloka is only to make us aware that even even if you die and become a devata, still you will remain finite, insecure only. So, is that something worth striving for, or that earlier state, what he said, Paramam Veditavyam, that supreme consciousness is what is to be known. Swasti Yuktva Maharshi Siddha Sanghaha. There are lots of Maharshis, Siddhas. In groups they are coming and they are praising you. Stuvanti Tvam Stutibhi Pushkalabhi. Many, many hymns they are singing, sublime hymns they are singing in your glory. So the devatas, the rishis. Then he says Rudraha. Now you see the divine beings he enlists here. Rudraha means all those who are in charge of the different types of destruction. They are called Rudras. They are Rudra Devatas. They are not, here it doesn't mean Lord Shiva, Rudra. These Rudra Devatas are these 11 Rudras are there. So different types of destruction they are in charge of. So Rudraha, Adityaha, 12 Adityas are there. So this Adityas are those who are sons of Aditi. Devatas are also called Aditya sometimes. Vasavaha, these are the 8 Vasus who are the seasons. If you remember in Mahabharata, this Bhishma was the 8th Vasu. You know, 7 children are offered by Ganga into the river. The 8th one is Bhishma. And something he had done that he got the curse. The 8 Vasus, they got the curse, but he was the main person, the 8th one, because of whom they got the curse. So he had to go through a longer span of life on the earth. So they are the 8 seasons. 8 Vasus, Vasavaha. Sadhyaha, they are the spirits of the sky. So the earth, the intraspace and the heavens. So the devatas, gandharvas, they all stay in the heavens. In the interspace are the sadhyas, this preta, pishacha, all of them, at different levels they are, these beings. So sadhyas, vishve ashvinam. So ashvinam, they are the twins, they are the doctors, divine doctors. Vishve devaha, they are the lords of the directions. Marutaha, the winds, various types of winds and storms and cyclone and hurricane and all that, they are classified as Marut. Marutaha, Ushma Pascha, and those beings who consume through steam, vapor. So they are called as the heat drinkers, Ushma, Pa. These are all divine. Some are divine, some are demonic. Different types of beings apart from the human beings. What, and the 84 lakh species that we know. Gandharvas, they are in charge of the music and dance and all that. Gandharva, Yaksha. Yaksha and Gandharva are in charge of music and dance. Gandharva, Yaksha, Asura. So these are the demons. Siddha Sanghaha and all these Siddhas. They all are looking at you. Vikshante Tvam Vismitas Chaiva Sarve. With such wonder they are looking at you. So Arjuna is seeing them. So now Gita is saying, all these beings are there. Don't ask the question, do ghosts exist? They definitely exist. So many different types of beings exist. Some of them are names given to make us aware that these are cosmic forces. Consciousness manifesting through these cosmic forces gets these names. And depending on what is their function, phenomenal powers, they get depicted in human forms also. That is only for human understanding. Otherwise, to understand power, how to understand? Like it is like saying Mother India. So the moment we say Mother India, what happens? We feel, no, this is my mother, my country. Is there some lady called Mother India? There is no person called Mother India. This whole country is Mother India, and that's the bhav that I have. So she is personified as Mother India. And then once that personification is done, then so many things happen. Everyone can show her in chains, and you know, she is crying, and then to make people realize to what our country is going through, all that depiction is done. So these phenomenal powers, they are consciousness manifesting through these powers. And each of them have a certain name. And you will be surprised if you go do research about other cultures. Lots of cultures have this. Just the names are different. But they will explain exactly the same thing. Cosmic forces personified. So the idea is that he is seeing all these cosmic forces. And now he sees, see, he saw Brahmaji earlier, then he saw Vishnu. Shivji, he sees in this form. One is, he must have seen the form in this whole thing. He sees a destructive aspect. So now he actually sees beings entering into the Lord's mouth and getting destroyed. So he says here, this Ugra Rupa now, slowly he builds it up. 23rd one, he says, Rupam Mahatte Bahu Vaktra Netram. Your form is very glorious with so many heads and eyes. Mahabaho Bahu Bahu Rupadam. Many, many strong hands and feet and all that. Bahudaram Bahu Danshta Karalam. You have a huge belly and many tusks. Danshta Karalam means sharp teeth. What are they called? Front teeth are called canine, no?
Incisors.
Sharp
ones.
Sharp ones. This is like that. You are in the cosmic form, he sees the tusks. Further description is terrible what is going to come. But the Drishtva Loka Pravyatita Pravyatitas Tathaham. All the beings in so many lokas, when they look at this destructive form, they all are very scared, and including me, I am also scared, he says, Akathaham. Nabas Prishad Dikta Maneka Varnam. Touching the sky, very shining, brilliant form of many, many different colors. Vyatananam Dikta Vishala Netram. And such huge eyes that you have. Rishtvahi Twam. Pravyachitantaratma, looking at those eyes only one gets scared. Dhritimna Vindami, I am not able to hold my inner strength. I am getting very nervous. Dhritimna Vindami, Shamancha Vishnu. So he says here, I can't hold my courage, nor can I hold my peace. I am getting very disturbed now with this form. Now you see what he says. Damsta karavani chate mukhani, looking at these terrible tusks on your, in your mouth. Drishtvaiva kala nala sannivhani, they are like time. They are like fire, kala anala. You know, the blazing fire of time which burns everything, your tusks are like that. Dishona jane labna labhecha sharma, I have forgotten this, all directions. Prasida Devesha Jagan Nivasa, said, oh Lord, please have some mercy and come down to some normal form. So this is very difficult. Now he sees something which is actually going to happen. So he sees all the Kauravas going into the mouth of Bhagavan and getting killed. Amichatvam Dhritarashtrasya Putraha. All the sons of Dhritarashtra. Sarve Sahaivava Nipala Sandrihi, with all these so many different kings who have come to fight. And he also sees Bhishmaha, Dronaha, Sutaputraha, Karna, Tatha Asav, Saha Asmadiyai Rapi Yodha Mukhyai. And also our great warrior chiefs, not only theirs, our people, their people, all of them. Vaktranite Varamana Vishanti. With such speed they are going into your mouth. దంష్టాకరాలని భయానకాన్ని. బిట్వీన్ దీస్ టూ టస్క్స్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ దే ఆర్ ఎంటరింగ్ కేచిత్ విలగ్న దశనాంతరేషు. సమ్ ఆర్ ఫౌండ్ స్టక్ బిట్వీన్ ద గ్యాప్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ టీత్ ఆల్సో, మీన్స్ దే ఆర్ గెటింగ్ కిల్డ్. Just like food gets stuck and the toothpick we remove, no? He says some of the beings are stuck between the teeth of your mouth. Sandrishyante chulita irutta mangai, and they are becoming powdered as well. Means you are just consuming them. It is like saying that the ocean is consuming all the waves. From one standpoint, it looks very terrible. Oh God, ocean has consumed all the waves. From other standpoint, it is a natural thing which keeps happening. So he sees this very terrible sight that these people all are getting. So he gives an analogy. Just like the rivers, yatha nadinam bahavangu vegaha. So many rivers which are flowing with such great speed, samudramaiva vimukha vidravanti, they all go and get become one with their ocean. Tatha tavami naraloka viraha, in that same way all these great warriors, vishanti vaktani abhivijvalanti, they are entering your flaming blazing mouth. Just like if you take some ahuti and offer swaha and put it in the fire. It's like that. So many warriors and beings and all of them are entering into the mouth of the Lord and they are getting killed. So this rivers entering the ocean, the analogy has a limitation because the rivers are inert. Rivers don't feel anything. So Vedavyasji feels that it is, somebody may misunderstand, oh, these people are all entering but they don't feel anything. So he rectifies that analogy, gives another analogy now. He says, yatha pradeeptam jvalanam vita patangaha, just like the moth, so many moths. Is that expression correct? Moths?
Yes.
Plural is correct? Moths. They enter into the fire. Now, that is self-immolation. How they will burn, they will feel that. Vishanti nashaya sarvuddha vega. With such speed they go and they just immolate themselves because they have such attachment to the light, to that brilliance. In that same way, tathaiva nashaya vishanti lokaha, not only the earth, it says all the 14 worlds as though are moving towards you in such great speed, tavapi vaktrani samriddha vegaha, they are just entering into your mouth and you are getting destroyed. So the further description he goes, he gives, it's very strange what he says now. He says, Yelijyase grasamana samanta. He says, you are devouring, Yelijyase means you are licking. Now we take chutney and achar. He says, you are licking all these people and just means their death is like a pickle for you. In this Kathopanishad, that's one analogy given. Mrityuhu yasya upasechanam. Death is like a pickle for that Supreme Self. It's like that all these people who are entering, you are licking, you are enjoying this rasamana samanta. Lokan samagram vadanay jvaladbihi. They are coming into your mouth, all these lokas, and they are getting destroyed and they are getting burnt. And you are enjoying that. Tejo virapurya jagat samagram. You are splendorous and this whole world is filled with your splendor. Bhasasta vogra pratapanti vishnu. But with your rays and with your brilliance, everyone is as though getting scorched. So he as though accuses Bhagavan that, wow, what kind of a Bhagavan you are. You are eating your own creation and you are enjoying that. But the point there is that he only has become known all this. It is like saying that the waker is enjoying the death of the dream. The waker's mind only is the whole dream world, all the dream characters. And when that waker wakes up and the whole dream as though is eaten up by the waker, what is there to cry in that? That's from that waker standpoint. If I am identified with one dream character, gone. So now when he as though says this, how can you enjoy this sight? I mean, how can you enjoy this action that so many are getting killed? So now Bhagavan has to give his defense. So now Bhagavan speaks. Shri Bhagavan Vacha. Kalosmi Loka Kshaya Krit Pravriddhaha. Lokan Samahartum Iha Pravriddhaha. Te pitvam na bhavashyanti sarve. Ye vasthita pratyani keshu yodha. So Bhagavan speaks from the standpoint of the Supreme. So what does he say? Kalosmi, I am the time. Lokakshayakrit pravrittaha, and I am ever engaged in destroying. The job of time is to destroy. That's the adjective is given here to time. And if you think about it, it is like that. Anything you leave it, what happens to that in time? It just deteriorates and gets destroyed only, completely. He says, I am that time which devours everything. Lokan samahartum iha pravrittaha. So I am engaged in destroying many, many worlds constantly. Means what? One aspect of this is that change is a constant in this world. Everything is changing, and change means death. And time is equal to change is equal to death. This will go hand in hand. Sorrow comes to us not because of time or change or death. Sorrow comes to us because of attachment. Imagine if death is not there. What will happen? Terrible things will happen. The seed will never be able to give birth to a plant. Because the seed has to die for the plant to grow. Nothing will happen only in the creation. And suppose we don't die, what a musibat that is. Nobody dies. People are going on born. What will happen? Whole world have there will be no place in it. And worst thing is we all become reduced in size, in time. Terrible life, no? Now only it's such a terrible life. After 60, 70, 80, such pain in the body. Only waiting for death to come, but death also doesn't come. Imagine if we don't die at all. Ashwatthama was given that curse. For all that he did, Ashwatthama's curse that Krishna Bhagavan gave him is that you will not die. And you will live like a sick person. And he took away that money of Ashwatthama. Till the end of this kalpa, Ashwatthama has to live. He can't die. At least the grace of Bhagavan, at the end of the kalpa, he will die. Suppose somebody doesn't die only. Horrible. That's a curse. So he says, I am that time which devours everything. And now he gives one proper shot to Arjun. He's saying, Rite Pitvam na Bhavishyanti Sarve. Arjun, even if you don't fight, these people are not going to survive. Ye vastita pratyanikeshu yodhaha. They have all these warriors who have assembled here. They all are going to die. Why? Not because Bhagavan wants to kill them. Because their karma only will lead them to that. So the system is created in the world. And according to that system, everything keeps happening. Bhagavan is not doing anything, you know, that if Duryodhan enters his mouth, he enjoys much more than somebody else, and he cries when Bhishma enters his mouth. That's a depiction which is given here, that he sees death. Imagine seeing destruction at a massive scale, which is what? In a cosmic form, it is not going to be all rosy. Because death itself and destruction is a part of creation. Until something doesn't get destroyed, no new creation will happen. So if I am seeing the whole creation and in that cosmic form, I am going to see destruction also in that cosmic scale. And that will disturb. So when Arjun sees this whole thing, and Bhagavan gives him one practical advice, he says, you do your duty. By your not fighting, you can't prevent them from dying. And nor will you be responsible for their death. If you do your duty in the spirit of duty, you are not responsible for their death. Prithe pitvam na bhavishyanti sarve. Even without you. So very powerful shloka is going to come that we will see tomorrow, which speaks about predetermination. At one level we say everything, you know, there is a choice, we can change. But at a higher level we say that there is no choice. Everything is already predetermined and it will happen. Whether you are there or not, I am there or not, it will anyway happen. Because that has to happen. One may say, no, that's the collective karma soul. It is not predetermined. Okay, that's the lower standpoint we take. From highest standpoint, it is there predetermined. So about that we will see tomorrow. Very beautiful shloka, 33rd one. And we will take up tomorrow.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.